Under ytan så är det otroligt komplext för att man ska kunna lösa ut sina uppgifter.
We'll see a much more intense focus on the undersea domain with critical infrastructure, with submarine operations, with drones or uncrewed naval and maritime vehicles of all kinds of sorts. And we will need to find ways to counter that as well as to use it to our advantage.
Though its waters may be brackish and shallow, the Baltic Sea remains one of the most important oceans in the world from a geopolitical point of view, especially now when global tensions are once again on the rise. Vital infrastructure, such as Nord Stream 2, adds yet another dimension to its significance. Needless to say, protecting the Baltic Sea in general, and specifically its underwater domain, is regarded as a crucial factor in keeping the peace in the region. But doing so has never been more complicated. Is it even possible? Let's find out. This is Shielding the Baltic Sea Under the Surface, Part 2. In the previous episode, we dove into a hidden world riddled with challenges such as treacherous terrain, low temperatures, and severely limited visibility, paired with the Baltic Sea's uneven seabed topography and narrow straits. It makes for a truly hostile environment. To make matters worse, many of these characteristics also work in the favor of a potential aggressor. This makes defending this subsurface domain a daunting task. Advanced technologies and decades of experience have allowed us to adapt accordingly. And today, we'll look at the extraordinary efforts that help keep the area safe.
Östersjön är i många stycken ett väldigt unikt och speciellt hav. Det är väldigt grunt, medeldjup ungefär 55 meter. Bottentopografin är väldigt skiftande. Över året så är salthalten och temperaturen också den skiftande. Alla dessa faktorer påverkar hur ljudet utbreder sig. Och ljudutbredningen, den är viktig för oss när vi söker efter ubåtar, när vi söker efter minor. Detta påverkar förstås den materiel och den utrustning som vi behöver för att lösa vår uppgift.
We cannot see below the surface, which means we need systems and sensors, submarines, as well as human intelligence to get a full maritime domain awareness of what's happening on the seafloor, as well as below the surface. And to use that intelligence and to use that information to inform policymakers and military decision makers. And it's very important because it has become a warfighting and a domain in our conflicts of our time. Historically, underwater defense was all about submarines. Submarines fighting, attacking enemy merchant shipping, but also navies attacking these enemy submarines. This is World War I, World War II. Nowadays, in the Cold War, since the Cold War, but also particularly since the end of the Cold War, we see much more traffic under the sea. We see drones, we have a lot of maritime infrastructure down there, we have sensors and systems. So defense has become much more complicated.
The conventional way of monitoring underneath the sea is using sonars connected to a ship or helicopter. By emitting a sound signal, usually a ping, into the water, you can then listen to the echo when it bounces back. By measuring the time it takes for the sound to travel to an object and back, sonar can determine the distance to that object. Today, more advanced sonars, including side scan and multi-beam sonars, can provide a high-resolution image of the sea floor.
För att kunna försvara sig i en skärgårdsmiljö eller i Östersjön så behöver man ha en helhetsförmåga. Det är viktigt att man tar den holistiska aspekten. Du behöver kunna ha operationell förmåga i alla domäner. Och du behöver kunna distribuera datan på ett väldigt effektivt sätt.
We'll see a much more intense focus on the undersea domain, with critical infrastructure, with submarine operations, with drones or uncrewed naval and maritime vehicles of all kinds of sorts. And we will need to find ways to counter that, as well as to use it to our advantage in conflicts, both current ones as well as future ones. And we need to make policymakers aware that the undersea domain is at least as important as the air domain and at least as important as the land domain, because it's such a crucial way. More than 95% of our internet traffic goes on by sea cables. Our energy infrastructure is down there under the water. And all these things matter to everyone, not just people living by the coast.
Using underwater autonomous and remotely operated vehicles enhances our capacity to continuously monitor the subsurface domain. It helps us to fortify maritime security protocols by offering both great awareness and early threat identification. While active sonars and engagement systems play a vital role, the foundation of most underwater surveillance lies in passive techniques, such as underwater microphones and sensors designed to detect anomalies. These can be mounted on ships or placed on the ocean floors, for instance. These passive sensors collect valuable data that is later processed. With the added advantages of intelligent optimization and automation, we can also streamline the responsibilities of operators and decision makers.
När vi utvecklar system, då ser vi hela tiden till att det finns en buffert, en uppgraderingsmöjlighet. Och det är i hela kedjan för att du ska kunna få ut relevant förmåga. Och i och med att omvärldshotet hela tiden förändras, vi vet ju om det när vi utvecklar våra system och förbereder oss för det helt enkelt. Vi vet aldrig vilket hot vi står inför, men vi vet att vi kommer behöva ha system som kan uppgradera sig över tid.
Locating a hostile force or adversary beneath the sea can indeed be a challenging task. This realm often remains shrouded in the fog of war, underscoring the need for advanced capabilities and experts in underwater warfare. Anti-submarine helicopters, aircraft and surveillance ships are invaluable assets in the pursuit of underwater threats. Equipped with specialized weapons and technology, they play a pivotal role in countering submarine dangers and surveying the underwater domain. When continuously monitoring against underwater threats from drones or smaller submersible vehicles, an additional range of measures and equipment becomes necessary. This new frontier prompts many navies and states to rethink their doctrines to counter these evolving threats. Adaptation and continuous upgrades to the software and hardware are needed to effectively ensure defense capabilities in an ever-changing technological landscape. As we resurface from the challenging depths of the Baltic Sea, a deeper understanding of its unique challenges has been gained, alongside an appreciation for those who dedicate their lives to ensuring its safety and security. Safeguarding our critical underwater infrastructure demands both skill, endurance, and technological prowess, as well as the ability to outmaneuver potential adversaries. Allocating resources to underwater protection perhaps lacks the immediate allure of investing the same amount in a new ship that's clearly visible from the coast. A crucial lesson learned is that the underwater domain cannot be ignored, and both our existing and new equipment must be tailored to meet tomorrow's challenges in this realm. It's essential to keep in mind that all domains are interconnected. In the next episode, we turn our attention to the surface, where threats seem more visible. But is it that easy? This domain is as complex as the one under the surface, with its own unique challenges. Let's explore the threats, surveillance, and deterrence challenges of the open seas in the next episode.